I honestly have no idea how I'm supposed to follow up the last hour that I've just witnessed inside this church. So, before anything else, let me just say thank you to all the parents inside here for raising these amazing, amazing children. And let me say thank you to the senior class of 2017 for giving me the honor to address you tonight in your shiny purple costumes. When I was a kid, one of my most prized possessions, maybe even more cherished than the giant box of Legos my siblings and I shared, maybe even more important than my bike, was a tennis racket. Maybe nothing unusual there, except here's the thing, I didn't play tennis. I didn't know how. I didn't want to know. No, I loved and I cherished this tennis racket, not for what it was, but for what it could become. You see, turned around sideways, this tennis racket, this wood and nylon became an electric guitar. And I went from a nerdy 10-year-old obsessed with Tolkien, Star Wars, to a rock and roll god. I became David Bowie. I became Bruce Springsteen. I became Prince. Well, not Prince. No one can become Prince. Setting the bar a little high. But even then, leaping around my room, just furiously strumming and whipping windmills and scissor kicks. Let's go crazy, blaring from my little tape deck, and imaginary fans cheered my tennis racket guitar solos. I knew this is what I wanted to be. This was going to be my life. Now you're wondering, man, Mr. Schultz, what happened? Well, to be truthful, I had a lot of dreams for my future. In addition to ripping epic guitar solos on stages all over the world, I also wanted to climb mountains that no one had ever climbed before. I wanted to discover a lost city of gold and, if possible, accompany a wizard and a band of dwarves, kill an evil dragon and claim his treasure. Dream big, right? And then one day, my fourth grade teacher asked the class what we wanted to do when we grew up. And one by one, we went around. And many of my peers stated their desired futures uncertainly, almost like questions. It'd say, doctor? Teacher? Lawyer? Regardless, after each one, the teacher nodded and assured the kid that she would do great, and then she moved on. And when it came my turn, I said, with absolute commitment, I am going to play lead guitar in a rock and roll band. And she just stood there. There was no nod. So I thought she wanted to hear more. So I went on, said, I want to build a roller coaster in my backyard. I want to find a magic ring that'll turn me invisible, and if need be, I will volunteer to lead a mission to blow up the Death Star. And then she cut me off. No, she said, I mean, what do you want to be? You grow up. I looked at her. Jedi Knight. Duh. No, she said again. Like a job. Like a real career. Like a carpenter. Or a police officer. Or, and she paused, and I leaned forward as if she could actually see into the future. And then she smiled. And she said, an optometrist. And look, no disrespect to optometrists or doctors or carpenters or lawyers or police officers, but if what you were really asking was what do I want to be when I grow up, the answer was, and honestly still is sometimes, a Jedi Knight. Or at least a pilot for the Resistance. And maybe you're looking at me, and you're still trying to reconcile my tennis racket guitar god self with your English teacher. Maybe you're still wondering, yeah, but you gotta know, what happened? Now, if you've been in my classroom, you know the important question is not what happened, but so what? Who cares? Why does this matter? Well, you see, when my teacher put a stop to my extended list of what I wanted to do and asked me for one thing that I wanted to be, she was making an incredibly important distinction. As far as I can remember, that was the first time someone had noted, even if only peripherally, the critical difference between wanting to be something and wanting to do something. And this might not be a matter of life and death, but it just might be the difference between life with a capital L and something that just kind of sort of vaguely resembles lowercase life. At the time, I was too young to understand just how important this difference could be. There are a lot of things that we do understand as children. We understand how to be spontaneous, how to create games and stories and entire neighborhoods of imaginary friends, how to be endlessly curious, how to forgive others immediately, how to approach the world with wonder and joy, and how to believe that nothing matters quite as much as what's happening right now. Some of those things we seem to forget with surprising frequency, and we have to relearn again and again. And other things we only learn as we age, because time, as all of you parents know, never stands still. I became a father in 2005, and my son, Harper, will be a seventh grader at Lake Braddock next year. Shout out to the Bruins. And my daughter, Maya, will be in fourth grade at Ravensworth. Shout out to the Ravens. And as you parents out there know already, and as many of you graduates will one day learn, there's no more bracing or shocking way to realize how little you know than by having a child. Seriously. It's not just sleep deprivation that makes you feel stupid, although that happens too. When I had children, what I realized very quickly was that I didn't really know what it meant to love someone. Now, there were things in my life that I loved. I loved my parents, my siblings, my wife. I loved a whole lot of aunts and uncles and cousins and friends, but not with that particular ferocity with which you wind up loving a child. And you will love that child ferociously. And you will laugh with joy that you've never imagined. You'll tell stories that you never knew that you could invent. You'll delight in another human being becoming every day more himself or herself. But you'll also learn how fast a year passes when you live it with your children. You'll look at your infant, and in an instant, he'll be in kindergarten. In another instant, he'll be too big to fit on your lap. He'll be embarrassed when you try to hug him in public. He'll graduate from sixth grade, and even if he calls you daddy at home, he'll call you dad when he's out with his friends. He'll graduate one day from high school. Time passes, and every moment that we treasure seems to slip from us at impossible speed and become the past. So, while yes, it is absolutely important that we take evenings like this to pause and reflect on our lives, it's also vital that we pay attention to and treasure those lives as they're happening. It won't change the reality that time passes, but it is a recognition that any particular moment, if you make it so, is sacred. That any particular moment, if you make it so, is miraculous. Now, this is not easy. It's difficult to be engaged and to stay engaged. But like most things of value and worth and consequence, like for example, your education, it takes work and it takes courage. and it takes a willingness to see the work itself as the reward. There's a poem by Lee Hunt called Rondo. It's not about a point guard. It reads, Jenny kissed me when we met. Jumping from the chair, she said, Time, you thief who love to get sweets into your list, put that in. Say I'm weary, say I'm sad, say that health and wealth have missed me. Say I'm growing old, but add, Jenny kissed me. And in that poem, we find a single moment, just one. A moment that maybe even on its surface seems insignificant. It's just a kiss, after all. But paid attention to, in the way that any of us can, it becomes important. It becomes sacred. It becomes a moment that, even if only briefly, can push back against what Shakespeare calls the wrathful siege of battering days. I may be weary now, the poem claims. I may be sad, and I may be old and in ill health. But I have, and I always will have, this. Jenny kissed me. In that moment, I was alive and delighted, and Jenny, she jumped from her chair, and she kissed me. And it reminds me, that poem does, of so many moments from my life. These fragments that might seem shallow, but which, if you step into them, are of surprising depth. These are the moments that I come back to and the moments that remind me how common we are as human beings, how alike our hearts and our spirits are, how we desire love and affirmation, and to believe that we are loved and are worthy of love, and that some other human being can see what we have always quietly and desperately hoped lay secretly inside of us. But we have to create those moments. We have to make the choice to honor those moments with our focus and our attention, not for the sake just of posting a photo on Instagram to be liked and forgotten, but for the sake of honoring ourselves and our lives. And doing so entails a certain amount of vulnerability. When you do that, you are one way or another admitting that you care deeply about something, that you care about this moment and the people around you. I'll tell you, those moments, those fragments of otherwise continuous time that have meant and continue to mean the most to me, they are those that have found me just exactly that, vulnerable, open, engaged. Those are the moments when my head and my heart and my whole self were on fire with possibility and wonder. Those are the moments when I realized that, as Issa pointed out, the stars don't turn their backs on us. Those are the moments when I saw through a window instead of just staring at a wall. When I moved toward risk instead of retreating toward familiarity and comfort. When I danced instead of just watching others dance. These were the moments in which the world felt bigger and richer and more complex and more mysterious than I ever suspected that it could be. And that richness and that complexity is beautiful, and it's priceless. And this is because simplification, as we get older, bores us. It's why we don't play Candyland as grown-ups. It's why watching a tic-tac-toe game between two adults is insufferable. There's no complexity. There's no richness. This is when we feel like our world is constraining us, and we withdraw, and we wilt, and we get bored, and we detach. And I remember reading an essay by Pauline Kael, a film critic, and she claimed in this essay that a movie must say yes, yes to the whole world, or else it says nothing. And when I first read that, I had no idea what it meant at all, but it stuck with me. It's easy to wish that the world were different, to wish that the people around you were different, to wish that your life were different. God knows I spent lots of time in high school and in college making those same wishes. But all making such wishes does is close you off to the world that actually is, from the people that actually are, and from the life that you right now are living. So here's what I've come to think. A life must say yes to the whole world, or else it says nothing. It doesn't mean that you turn a blind eye to injustice, God, no. It doesn't mean that you turn your back on those who suffer. You fight for justice, and you help those who are suffering. Saying yes to the whole world doesn't mean becoming complacent. Quite the opposite. It means every day making the difficult, difficult choice to love the world we have, even while you work to change it. And to love the life you have, even while continuing to create the person that you want to be someday. I wonder whether there are any parents or students out there who are looking at their watches and wondering, yeah, but when is he going to get to the practical stuff? When is he going to tell us what practical benefit high school had? Or how to get the highest return on investment for all this money I'm going to spend on 4 years of college? Well, I'm not. I've heard people say that school should be practice for or preparation for the real world. And in many ways, that's a deeply, deeply patronizing thing to say. It assumes that this wild and turbulent and difficult life that you've been living for the last 12 years was somehow not real, that it was fake. It assumes that your insecurities and your triumphs and your laughter and your tears were all somehow not quite real, just getting you ready for the real world. And I'm sure you've learned in the midst of some exalting or some joyous or some crushing moment, in the midst of just feeling all of those feels, that the idea that this is not the real world is obviously false. But looked at another way, there is a nugget of truth buried deep, deep in there. Primary school, secondary school, college, all can and should prepare you for the life still ahead of you, but not in the way that I think we sometimes assume. It's not just about training you for a future job. It's also about helping you discover what's important to you so that you can explore that as fully and as wonderfully as you can. And that's something that you can practice while you're in school, and you can practice it when you're not in school, but you have to practice it because it sure as heck does not seem to come easy. Instead, we think of school as a place to acquire immediately useful and practical skills, formula, facts, stuff that we can exchange in the future for goods and jobs and paychecks. And I think that's why we get so upset in school when what we're learning doesn't seem immediately useful. And this is when we cry out, I'm never gonna use this. And you're right to be upset in those moments, but this is important. That might be less a problem with the material at hand and more a problem with how we've learned to think about that material. It might be more a problem with what we consider worth doing, what's worth our time. What's worth doing is not simply what we can exchange in the future for jobs and paychecks. Those things matter, but there's more. What's worth doing, and this is something that children also know, and that adolescents sometimes struggle to remember, and what adults seem all too easily to forget, that's worth doing for its own sake. What's useful about spending time with friends? What's practical about playing music or reading a book or having children? Next year, in school or out, learn things because you want to learn them, not because you're supposedly guaranteed some arbitrary return on investment. Engage with the people around you, not in order to exchange them for their networking worth, but for the richness of their individual and awesome selves. They have worlds inside them. Create the self that you want to be, not just so that it will impress a hypothetical future employer, but because that self that you're creating feels like the truest possible version of you. Now, that might not be practical, but it also might save your life. And again, I'm not going to claim that this is easy or that it's something you can do once and then forget about. Creating yourself, discovering yourself, that's an ongoing process. It is. It's not something you did or accomplished and got a trophy for before you moved on to something else. It's like loving another person. You don't just do that. You don't just set your dial at love and then forget it. Every day, every moment, you make a conscious decision to love that person, to engage in the act of loving that Living that way is hard, it's risky, it's vulnerable, it takes courage, but it's also inspiring. It's the bold, it's the daring, it's the passionate that most inspire us. When I see you guys get up here on stage and share yourselves and your gifts and what you've learned how to do because you wanted to do it with other people, that's amazing and it's inspiring. It's those who put themselves on the edge, who dare ridicule, who dare failure, who just put it on the line, who say, yep, I might fall on my butt, but I'm doing it anyway. There's beauty in that courage. There's beauty in that engagement, in that willingness to engage with one's most passionate self. I tell you, you want to change the world? That's the way you do it. Not only is there something beautiful about such passion, there's also a genuine threat to the status quo. As Rogue One points out, hope itself is an act of rebellion. So back to that 10-year-old me. As I said at the time, I didn't understand how profound that difference between being and doing really is. I didn't understand it until just before I graduated from high school. That summer, I took a 15-day Outward Bound course in the Rocky Mountains. There were 8 of us, and we were all at the same point in our lives, and there were 2 instructors. And one night, they asked us to spend a little time writing about what we wanted to do later in life. And when we came back together to share our writing, I said, jokingly, that I planned to be an optometrist. And Gordon, who was one of the instructors, he gave me a look. Really? He said. Yep. I mean, like that's the job that you want to have? Sure, I said. That's fine. But that's not what I asked you. What I asked you was what you wanted to do, not what you wanted to be. What's the difference? I said. Look, at some point, he said, yeah, you're gonna need a job. But at every point, you're gonna need a life. Finding a job is important, but finding a life, that's everything. That rocked my world. Years later, I became an Outward Bound instructor. That was my dream at that point. I wanted to be an Outward Bound instructor. And after college, I got hired by the Voyager Outward Bound School to lead mountaineering and backpacking trips in Montana. And my first few weeks working as an Outward Bound instructor, being an Outward Bound instructor, it wasn't what I thought it was going to be. It didn't measure up. I wasn't enjoying it. But then, about 3 weeks in the midst of a 22-day, very challenging course, challenging students, I realized that my focus was wrong. What I was out here to do was not just to be an Outward Bound instructor, but to engage in the act of Outward Bound instructing. And that, too, rocked my world. Now what happened, speaking of rocking worlds, to those tennis racket dreams? Well, here's the thing. What I've come to realize is that as a kid, imagining that future life of epic guitar solos on stages all over the world, what I wanted and dreamed about was not playing music, but being a rock star. And those are totally separate things. And now, 3 decades later, once a week, I get together with 4 or 5 other middle-aged musicians in a neighbor's basement, and for a few hours, we play music. It's loud, it's sloppy, but it's joyous. And we engage not in being rock stars, but in playing music, and it's wonderful. I'm proud to be a teacher. Seriously, I am. No matter how casually the profession might get dismissed, those who can't do, teach. And no matter how viciously public education might get attacked, I am proud to be a teacher. But here's that difference. For as proud as I am to be a teacher, what I love is the act of teaching. Not every day is perfect. Not every student walks into my classroom engaged and in love with books and poetry. Not every student wants immediately to put down his or her phone and pick up King Lear or Invisible Man. But every student challenges me, and every student transforms me, and every student reminds me that if I'm going to be alive, truly alive, I have to say yes to every one of those challenges. I have to say yes to every moment that cracks me open and reveals me as vulnerable and human. I have to say yes to the whole world. Sometimes that yes is like a begrudging nod. Sometimes it's a surprised laugh. Sometimes it's a passionate cry. Sometimes it's a song. But it's always an affirmation. And that's what matters. That's why I care. So, as you go forward with your arms open, embracing and saying yes, with your faith before you, I say also, may the force be with you.